If you have unwanted dark marks, hyperpigmentation, brown patches, or melasma, let's talk about how to get rid of it, how to keep it away, and how to prevent new ones from coming. I've got a strategy for you, whether you are ballin' or ballin' on a budget. Okay, the number one mistake I see patients make is they focus on a single cream to get the job done. The truth is, hyperpigmentation and the whole process of melanogenesis, which is where you make the pigment, is super complicated. It takes the body 14 steps to produce the pigment called melanin and a super duper complex process called melanogenesis. So if you think that one cream that you bought from Sephora or Amazon is gonna do it, it's not so likely. You, my friend, need a complete anti-pigmentation solution. Spoiler alert, for anyone who doesn't like to layer a bunch of different products, there are two products that you could use to target every single pathway of melanogenesis. However, it does come with a pretty hefty price tag. Remember, these expensive products don't need to be used long-term. Initially, you can use them to control the pigmentation, then maintain them with less expensive alternatives. Don't worry, I'm gonna show you how. And of course, solid sunscreen measures with broad spectrum UV and visible light blockage, plus nice good glasses and a wide brim hat to protect you from the sun. Spoiler number two, you don't have to use any hydroquinone to get amazing results. I'm gonna show you how to build a regimen with products that work synergistically. The synergy of these actives outperform hydroquinone without any cytotoxicity. Yep, you're welcome. First things first, you have to be smarter than the melanocyte. Hyperpigmentation occurs when the melanocyte, which is the pigment producing cell, begins to produce too much pigment called melanin. This is what results in the dark spots or the brown patches that can even be a little gray in appearance on the skin. The melanocyte makes melanin or pigment in a oval structure called the melanosome. Let's not overcomplicate this. If you think of the melanocyte as a house and the melanin as the people that live in the house, the melanosome would then be the car that's in the garage. The melanosome can actually take the people that live in the house to and from where they need to go. It's their transportation. So the melanosome transport melanin to and from where it needs to go, usually surrounding keratinocytes. The surrounding keratinocytes connect to the stratum corneum, which is the topmost upper layer of the skin. And sometimes there are too many people in the house or there are uninvited guests that came to the house. So more melanin, and where more melanin occurs, that is when you get more pigmentation on the surface of the skin. So basically something has gone wrong, something has overstimulated the melanin or the melanocyte to make more melanin, more people, and that is what causes pigmentation to occur. Melanin is not only the pigment that gives your cell color, it also protects your cells from damage caused by UV rays. The most common cause of hyperpigmentation is a condition called post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation or PIH, where excessive pigment or melanin deposition occurs at the site of excessive skin inflammation or injury. From picking at the skin or choosing irritating skin ingredients over aggressive cosmetic procedures or using inflammatory ingredients. Common causes include acne, eczema, and pseudofolliculitis barbae, which is also known as razor bumps. Up to 85% of the population is affected by post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation or PIH, but it is more common in darker skin tones, though everybody can get it. It's really important if you have a darker skin tone, whether it's Asian olive or of African descent, that you really want to go to a physician or provider who is knowledgeable about your skin type. The wrong procedure, the wrong treatment, the wrong medication can send your skin into quite a flurry of irritation, which leads to more PIH. If you have acne, this is why I choose azelaic acid over something like a benzoyl peroxide. The way that benzoyl peroxide works on acne is it actually makes free radicals that kill the acne bacteria. Free radicals lead to irritation, but more importantly, those free radicals would render any type of skin lightening agents completely ineffective. So you're literally spinning your wheels trying to get rid of your acne and clear your post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation at the same time if you're using the wrong ingredients. Azelaic acid is so amazing. It targets the excess melanin without lightening the healthy skin. If you want more info on what other ingredients to avoid, check out my video here. Melasma results from an abnormal increase in the amount of pigment carrying cells, so too many cars. It's caused by hormonal changes, with the main culprit being pregnancy, which is why it's sometimes called the mask of pregnancy, but it can also occur from other hormonal things like birth control or hormone replacement therapy, in vitro fertilization. All of these things can cause the pituitary gland to make too much MSH or melanocyte stimulating hormone. When this happens, the MSH hormone is continuously leading to uncontrolled manufacturing of these melanosomes. There's also a large vascular component to melasma. You have to target the vessels in addition to the pigment for improved results and to decrease the chance of pigment relapse. The first thing everyone wants to know is, what skin lightening cream can I use? But the skin lightening cream is just a tiny piece of the puzzle. If your strategy doesn't include lifestyle changes, like that hot yoga class you keep going to, or the soy latte that you drink every day, or the blow dryer heat that is directed at your skin, you, my friend, will be spinning your wheels. Trying to start a skincare regimen without using the proper cleanser is like showing up to the marathon in your favorite Lululemon gear and your perfect running shoes, but not stretching before the race. It's likely going to result in injury, and you're not going to perform as well. Just using any old cleanser isn't going to cut it. Cleansers are critical because they prepare the skin. You're looking at the skin barrier, and this is what cleansers can affect in a productive or counterproductive way. This is a pH scale of the most common ingredient, and you can see how the cleansers can affect the skin's pH, which would then affect the penetration of the treatment product you put on it. For example, vitamin C or ascorbic acid, even glycolic acid, penetrate better at a lower pH of 2.
Hi. All right, guys, so I am back armed with my esteemed colleague, my daughter Nyla. Want to do what you're actually trying to accomplish is going to determine the cleanser that you're using. So if you're trying to accomplish removing oil, then you're going to want to go with a foamy cleanser. So you can remove those oils through the product that you're going to put on afterwards will actually penetrate and reach the skin. If you're feeling dry, then you actually are going to want to deposit lipids and make sure that you're not removing oil from your skin barrier. So you're going to go with more of a creamy type of cleanser. The most important thing to know about cleansers are that after you're done, your skin should feel clean, but it should also feel very soft, very supple, and hydrated. That is key. If you're feeling tight and like super clean, but also dehydrated, you're using the wrong cleanser.
Say bye-bye.
Let's talk exfoliation. Gentle exfoliation is amazing. It can be a true game changer. Over exfoliation is going to cause you a lot of trouble, more inflammation, and therefore lead to more melanin production and pigmentation on the surface of your skin. So you want to be really careful in what ingredients you're using to exfoliate. In general, I am team enzyme over acid when it comes to exfoliation for people suffering from pigmentation issues or with a darker skin tone, simply because a really strong acid can indeed lead to increased irritation, which again goes down that cascade of inflammation, stimulating more melanin and therefore more pigmentation on your skin. So if you go and you use one of these really strong glycolic acids at very popular brands, you may indeed just be causing yourself more harm than good, and it may be an immediate effect of brightening or improving in your skin texture. But remember that inflammation cascade takes a while to start, and melanin production can then show up as dark spots on your skin that are now worse from using the wrong products. So if you go with team enzyme over acids, you can kind of avoid all of that because enzymes allow you to gently exfoliate that top layer of the skin so you can actually desquamate it off, meaning rapidly turn it over without interrupting the healthy skin cells. You can then also allow it to increase the penetration of other ingredients that you're going to put on afterwards. It will allow you to interfere with that melanin production. So basically, remember, the keratinocyte has to receive the melanin from the melanosome.
Once a week?
You're gonna go once a week? Yeah, once a week, at the most twice.
BHAs, however, are anti-inflammatory, keratinolytic, and fat soluble, so perfectly safe and effective to use.
Okay, so because we're fighting hyperpigmentation, all of our actives should be based off of disrupting the melanogenesis pathway or actives that are going to support others that disrupt the melanogenesis pathway. Your number one line of defense in fighting hyperpigmentation is going to be sunscreen. In fact, if you don't nail this step, nothing else matters. You need to use the right sunscreen, broad spectrum, UVA, UVB, and visible light, infrared light if you can get that too, all in your sunscreen. But UVA, UVB, and visible light are non-negotiables. Nyla agrees. The right sun protection is everything in the fight against hyperpigmentation.
The first line to melanin increase is UV radiation. The second is visible light, especially in darker skin. Any strategy that's going to effectively target pigmentation has to stop the influence of UV radiation and visible light on the skin.
Pro tip, don't keep your sunglasses in the car. You know that little visor at the top? Because it's so hot in there. And then you're putting those really hot sunglasses directly onto your skin. That's what we're trying to avoid, is excessive heat. Visible light has been proven to worsen hyperpigmentation. So the iron oxides that are found in tinted sunscreens will protect against visible light. If you're having a hard time finding a sunscreen that's right for your specific skin color, Dermablend makes these little pigment drops that are fantastic. You can blend them with any sunscreen that you like, and you can kind of customize the tint to be perfect for you. So antioxidants are essential for any and everybody, but especially when you're fighting pigmentation. On a daily basis, I eat a diet that's really rich in antioxidants, but I do put antioxidants on my skin as well, and you should as well, because it helps to fight those free radicals. My choice of daily antioxidants are vitamin C and niacinamide, because not only are they antioxidants, they're also anti-inflammatory and they're photoprotective, so they're boosters to my sunscreen, and that is why I use them in the day. I know that a lot of people use them at night because they are photosensitive. But because they are photoprotective, that is why I like to use them in the day, because that is when I am fighting those free radicals from the sun damage the most, especially here in Florida. So it's important to try and stop the upregulation of the MSH hormone, because that can lead to the eumelanin, which is that brown, black melanin pigment. And the overproduction of that causes more and more pigment to come in those brown patches that are the classic melasma patches. There have been a few compounds that have proven to help with the upregulation and to stop the eumelanin synthesis in this pathway. Phytol has been proven to stop the upregulation of alpha MSH eumelanin synthesis, as it inhibits the MITF pathway, and this reduces tyrosinase and suppresses the alpha MSH without any side effects. Bonus, it's a natural molecule. Another is alpha bisabolol. It also inhibits the MSH activity. Dun, dun, dun. We're finally going to talk about tyrosinase inhibitors. Tyrosinase is the rate limiting step for melanin. So this is why you hear everyone talking about tyrosinase inhibitors when it comes to pigment. This is why tyrosinase inhibitors is what's marketed on most anti-pigmentation creams. It is a big deal, but it's not the only way to treat hyperpigmentation. So you're going to see lots of products listed here as tyrosinase inhibitors. Very important, but please don't just focus on this pathway. As you've learned, there's several other really important pathways, but it's time to let tyrosinase shine. So let's talk a little bit about it. Tyrosinase is actually stimulated by UV rays, surprise, surprise, but also MSH and growth factors. As I'm sure you know, if you've been fighting your pigmentation for a while, tyrosinase inhibitors are the most common and popular way to fight pigmentation. Reason being, they are readily available and we have a lot of data supporting them. It's been something that's been used for several years, but there are a lot of new products on the market that really have been showing a lot of promise. They're listed here. And so are their price tags. Some of them are quite pricey, but others are affordable. Tyrosinase inhibitors don't help the melanin that's already present or the hyperpigmentation that you're already seeing on your skin. What it does do is it helps prevent future melanin in area. The specific area that you're applying the tyrosinase cream will have a down regulation in the production of melanin in that area, and therefore will have less pigment on the surface of the skin. You're going to see a common trend here, because a lot of those antioxidants that we spoke about in step one are also tyrosinase inhibitors. So again, allicin, arbutin, hydroquinone, which is the gold standard for treating hyperpigmentation, kojic acid, mulberry extract, vitamin C, ascorbic acid or tetrahexadecyl ascorbate, cucumber, cysteamine, which is branded as Cispera, licorice root extract, glycolic acid, epidermal growth factors, phytol, N-acetylglucosamine, and oligopeptide 51. Recommended products for this step would be Cispera, Rin, The Ordinary, Antiage MD, as it targets all pathways of melanogenesis, Polish Choice, Urban Skin RX, Lytera, Skin Better Even Tone Correcting Serum, The Inky List, and the PCA skin pigment. L-DOPA and dopaquinone are the building blocks of pigment. Both are catalyzed by the enzyme tyrosinase, which is the copper-containing compound found in the melanosome. Products that act on this pathway are going to be vitamin C, cysteamine, mulberry extract, green tea leaf extract. Products recommended to downregulate this melanogenic step include SkinCeuticals, The Ordinary, The Inky, Antiage MD, and Cispera. This is one of my favorite steps that help with decreasing pigmentation because it's actually stopping melanin from being transferred to the neighboring keratinocyte. So remember, if the melanosome is the car, basically the car is hitting a roadblock because it can't get to where it needs to go. The ingredients that can do this are niacinamide, soy, but specifically unfermented and unpasteurized soy. Super duper important, stolic acid and vitamin A or the retinoid family. Recommended products for this step are going to be, again, Cispera, The Ordinary, Polish Choice, The Inky List, and Aveeno Positively Radiant. Okay, so here you're looking at how UV rays oxidize the lipid into free radicals, leading to cell membrane damage and stimulating melanocytes to actually make more melanin. You're already covered here with your sunscreen and your antioxidants. All right, another favorite, everybody loves number 7, which is the increase or the rapid turnover of cells. So basically, again, desquamation, sloughing off of the old pigmented cells. We love this one because our good old faith and truth, Retin A, can do this. But you want to be sure you're using the right Retin A for you because over-irritating your skin can lead to pigmentation. I think I've nailed that into the ground by now. So remember, irritation, inflammation is the enemy. So you do want to rapidly turn over your cells. We know the Retin A does that and it does it well, but you don't want to over-irritate yourself. So I like retinol or retinaldehyde, especially if you're trying to fight pigmentation, because those have been known to significantly turn over the cells without causing the type of irritation that's happening with a retinoic acid or a prescription type of Retin A. I know, probably not what you expected to hear from the dermatologist, but this is all about decreasing your pigment, doing it safely, doing it effectively. Inflammation. It's literally the fuel to pigmentation. We have to, at all costs, decrease the inflammation. Melanozyme, or ligand peroxidase, targets the excess eumelanin in the upper layer of the skin. So eumelanin is the brown-black pigment, and it breaks it down without affecting melanogenesis biosynthesis in any other way. Super smart little guy. To date, the melanozyme ligand peroxidase can only be found in the Elore product. So tranexamic acid is a medication that can actually work on the vascular component of pigmentation. It can be used as a topical cream, but it can also be taken as an oral medication, so a pill that can be prescribed by your physician. But in this case, it really does help to reduce that angiogenesis or that neovascularization. My friend, you're probably using the wrong moisturizer right now. Do you know if the fatty acid is saturated or unsaturated? Saturated fatty acids will actually make pigmentation worse. Moisturizers are super important. They're also my favorite step in the skincare regimen. Did you know that using the wrong moisturizer can actually worsen your pigmentation? Yep. You want to use unsaturated fatty acids when you're actually using a moisturizer because that's going to downregulate and decrease tyrosinase and function. You're welcome. So let's kind of back up a little bit.
Why are moisturizers so important?
Moisturizers are super important because they can also affect the treatment product penetration, the efficacy, and side effects of the treatment product. Fatty acids that are in moisturizers can actually affect tyrosinase and how well it works. Unsaturated fatty acids will decrease tyrosinase function, and fatty acids are listed as oleic acid, which will allow for the ingredients to actually penetrate more, whereas a stearic acid will cause less penetration of an ingredient. Those with pigmentation concerns should only use unsaturated fatty acids, so the alpha linoleic acids, the linoleic acids, and the oleic acid. These will increase cell turnover of the stratum corneum and decrease tyrosinase function. Saturated fatty acids like palmitic acid are actually going to increase tyrosinase function and hence darken skin. So avoid saturated fatty acids in your moisturizer. I want you to go look at your moisturizer right now and then comment below whether it's a saturated fatty acid or an unsaturated fatty acid. Changing your moisturizer can make a big difference in your fight against pigmentation.
If you found that you've done all of these steps and you're still having some pigmentation issues, it's time to go see your dermatologist. There's plenty of treatment options that are very successful, so don't feel discouraged. Just go in for a visit. There are lots of different things that you can actually do very successfully that are not invasive that will heal your pigmentation. If you guys are interested in a treatment video for melasma, I'm more than happy to do it. I didn't add it to this video because it would have been another 30 minutes. So let me know if that's something you're interested in and I'll be more than happy to do it. Congratulations! You are now equipped with the knowledge you need to build the proper regimen. I sincerely hope this video helped you. Please let me know what other type of videos you'd like me to make. Until next time, be well.